Happy Mother's Day, everybody, on this Sunday, May 10th, 2020. This is Alan Arnette, and welcome to Virtual Everest 2020, Support the Climbing Sherpas. This weekend update, we take a look back in our fictional team. They had a big, big week. They made it all the way up to Camp 3 on the Lhotse Face, and they spent the night. They got hit by a tremendous windstorm, but survived it and went all the way back down to base camp, and that's where they are now. So looking forward, they've now done their rotation to the critical Camp 3, and I always say that's when you get your ticket to the top, because if you can't get there in style, then you probably don't have a chance to go to the summit. But all of our team members made it along with their personal Sherpas and guide. So now they're going to go back down to base camp and kind of rest up and see when the weather window emerges. And this is always a difficult time. So this upcoming week, a couple of very exciting things I'm going to have on this blog series. One is I'm going to be interviewing Tendi Sherpa and talking to him about what's it really like on the ground in Nepal right now for the Sherpa community. And then also Michael Fagan, I'm going to talk to him. He's been forecasting weather on Everest for, I don't know, a long time. We'll find out when I do the interview with him. So those two interviews will be coming up this week as we let our team rest up. But every day there'll be something new coming out on the blog. Okay, up next, though, I'm really excited to be interviewing my good friend Garrett Madison of Madison Mountaineering. Garrett started his company back in 2014, and I have climbed now with Garrett multiple times, including to the summit of K2 in 2014, summited on my 58th birthday, if you can believe that. Then I also went back with Garrett in Lhotse to attempt Lhotse in 2015. Unfortunately and tragically, the earthquake stopped that. But anyway, we talk about a lot of different things in this interview, and I hope you enjoy it. Thanks for following along. Really appreciate it. Hey, everybody. Alan here. I'm always excited to speak with these guide companies around the world, but Garrett Madison is a special guy in my heart. We made it to the top of K2 in 2014. He put me up there as the oldest American at 58 on my birthday. Garrett, let's start there. Thank you so much, and appreciate you joining us on this Sunday.
Hey, thanks for having me, Alan. And bringing back that memory of standing at the top of K2 with you back in 2014, July 27th. Wow, what a day that was. I think we all went into that expedition knowing that our chances of getting to the top were pretty low statistically. And it was a really dangerous, challenging climb with all the statistics. And we got lucky, and we were persistent, and we got to the top. And man, what an experience being up there with you. And I just feel so fortunate and lucky looking back to have that memory and that experience, because we just never know how many of those we're going to get.
Oh, exactly. I mean, and the success rate is so low on K2, as you've seen over the years that you keep going back. You've guided, 10 people now to the top?
Yep, 10 people to the top over 5 attempts. The only time I've been successful on K2 was in 2014 with you. And in 2018, the other 3 times, 15, 16, and 19, we ended up turning back for various reasons, high avalanche condition, mostly. It's the cards you dealt.
You know, I remember, and then we'll move on, but I remember talking to you it was March or February, and we were talking about schedules and stuff, and so you kind of had it laid out that, okay, then we're going to arrive in Pakistan, then we're going to go, you know, do the trek in the Baltero, and we should summit on July 27th. And I remember when you said that, I laughed and said, that's my birthday. And we both laughed and said, what are the odds that this will actually happen? It was really low, but it did. Well, so I'm noticing the shirt that you're wearing, and I guess I have some inside information that you're not in the Pacific Northwest. So where are you during this quarantine time?
So I am in Hawaii. Back whenever it canceled in mid-March, I decided to do my quarantine out here on Oahu. So I came in before the lockdown began, and I've just been hunkered down here. And I have to say, it's pretty nice. I can't complain.
What's the environment like there on the Oahu? You said you're at.
Yes.
Is it? What's the? Is everybody locked down like everybody on the mainland?
Yeah. So social distancing measures are in place, but people are still able to get out to the beaches and get in the water and go for hikes. Everyone is supposed to wear a mask when they're out in public in the grocery store doing errands. So it's different, but it's not a bad place to be here on lockdown.
So when China closed Everest because of the pandemic, and then Nepal followed suit, it's not totally unprecedented, because 2014 because of the dust and the ice fall, and 15 because of the earthquake, but the mountain was virtually closed. But this time, I don't think it's ever been closed in advance of the season starting. So what was your reaction? Did you agree with the decision for the countries to close it down? Or did you think it was an overreaction?
Initially, I was shocked. I didn't think that Everest would be closed because of the coronavirus. But I don't think any of us really imagined what would happen as things unfolded throughout March and April. So I was very surprised. And I agree with both China and Nepal's decisions to close the mountain. They're doing what they think is best for their country and their people. And they've got access to the best information in the world, what the WHO puts out. And I respect their decision. It's their mountain and it's their population they're looking after. And they have to make a decision on what the safest way to proceed is. And so I fully respect that and embrace that. However, I have to say I was very, very disappointed, because Everest means so much to me. Just as a personal experience that I go through every year, between the working with the Sherpas and the climbers and going through the process of taking on this enormous challenge in our lives and working through it day by day and hopefully getting to the top and having a successful, safe expedition. But giving that up was tough for me to let go of Everest.
What did you feel about Denali being closed?
Well, that was a tough one too, because after Everest was closed, I thought, well, what can I do this spring? And I was talking with a company and got a Denali permit lined up that I could bring a group on. And so I was getting really excited and talking to some clients about it, and we were getting things ready to lock in. And then I got an email that said Denali National Park just closed their whole season. And I thought, oh, here we go again. You know, you can't make plans right now.
And so, Rainier's the same way, right?
Yep, exactly. It was the same way. So I think for all of us, it got to a point where so many things got canceled that we just have to wait and see, and to embrace the reality of the quarantine, the lockdown, and just taking it day by day.
So you're kind of unique in the world of mountain guiding companies. You started Madison Mountaineering in 2014. That's when you founded it. And today you're the founder, the president, and you're the expedition leader. And we were talking that, I say you're unique from the perspective that when you run an expedition, you actually climb, and you've guided more clients to the summit of Everest than any other Western guide in the world. So you have quite the touch when you talk about that for you personally. I think that's why it maybe is so unique for you compared to maybe other owners or founders or presidents of expedition companies. So in that sense, your clients, I know you and I have a very close, tight relationship, and yes, that's who you are. How did your clients feel when you had to tell them that, it's over for the spring?
I think it was pretty tough initially for anyone who puts so much planning, preparation, and sacrifice into a goal. It's tough to give it up. These clients have been training months and years, maybe decades, to go take on this challenge, and they've put a lot into it. They've taken a lot of time. They've sacrificed a ton, and to have that taken away is tough. So I think initially, They were struggling with it, but we all have to come to the terms of what the situation is. And in the end, they embraced the decision by the governments of China and Nepal to close the mountain and to pivot and focus on the future and make the best we can out of it. And most of them will come back in 2021, hopefully, spring Everest.
Well, of course, the clients pay to go, and the Sherpas are paid to support the members. And you typically have a fairly large number of Sherpas. So how did your Sherpa, your climbing Sherpa family, how did they react, and how are they today?
Well, that was tough for them as well. And I think for me and the Sherpa team I work with, Everest means more to us than just the business side, the finances of it. We really have a lot invested. We believe in the mountain and the closeness and the community that it provides. And just the experience and process of climbing the mountain. But there's obviously a financial side to it as well. And for the Sherpas, it was tough for them. But they reached out to me, I reached out to them, and they said, hey, take good care, stay safe, stay healthy. We're going back to our villages. Let's reconnect and check in when this thing all passes and normalizes. And we're looking forward to seeing you in the autumn. So I'm planning to go in the autumn to Nepal, if it's possible, just to see them and reconnect with them face to face.
Great. I was going to ask you this. And so are you going to be running an expedition in the fall, or just you're going to go make a visit?
I don't know yet. So I have tentative plans for a couple different fall expeditions in the Himalaya, an 8,000 meter peak expedition, and then an Amitablam expedition. So those are tentatively scheduled, but we're just taking everything day by day. And we know that Nepal may not be open, or if it is, it may not be possible to travel there and climb. So we're just taking it day by day and waiting to see what the government says.
Any plans for more first ascents? You're kind of carving out a little niche doing first ascents in Nepal these days.
Yeah. We're actually looking at a couple of peaks over in the Makalu region, 6,000 meter peaks that haven't been climbed before, and doing as much research as I can right now, trying to figure out the access and potential routes on these peaks. But gosh, I just love going after the unclimbed peaks. It's a real special exploration and journey to go to a new mountain.
I don't think you would have been happy having a career being an accountant or something like that. So on, this is Sunday, May 10th, 2020. What would Madison Mountaineering be doing on Everest on this Sunday in the first week?
We would be gearing up to make our summit bid from base camp. So we would be getting ready to head up on that final rotation to go for the summit. We'd probably be leaving in a day or two from base camp to head up to camp two, and then from there on upwards to camp three and four and make our attempt. So this is right when we've done all of our hard work in Nepal at Everest Base Camp, all of our rotations, all the high camps are stocked with other equipment, oxygen, gear, food. People are rested, and we're ready to go on the final journey, the final push up the mountain and see what unfolds.
By this point, so a couple of questions. One is that this year, were you going to be hosting the rope fixing team again above Camp 2?
So this year, I was not. We had bid on the project with the Expedition Operators Association, but another company came in with a much lower bid, and we just couldn't compete with that number. There's certain fixed costs that we have, and we weren't willing to lose lots of money to do a project that at best is just a break even for us.
Yeah, that makes total sense. You did it last year. So tell us about that experience working with those Sherpas. I mean, those guys, I don't think people really understand the difficulty of fixing the ropes above Camp 2 up the Lhotse face and all the way up the Southeast Ridge and that whole, you know, it's dangerous and it's hard work. Tell us about those Sherpas.
Oh gosh, those guys are the real heroes on Everest. And I don't think many people appreciate the rope fixing project. Essentially, the crew that does the rope fixing project opens the route from Camp 2 to the summit for the whole community of Everest climbers there on the south side of the mountain. So it's a huge responsibility, and to do it in a safe and responsible and timely way is hard. It's a lot of work. And last year, the weather was tough from late April on through mid-May. High winds, as we know, on the north side, they lost lots of tents. At Camp 2 on the south side, the teams lost lots of tents. It was tough, and it was really hard for the Sherpas to get up high in the mountain above Camp 3 to work. But eventually, they got up there to Camp 4, and they got the job done. And to me, they're the real heroes of the mountain because they really put themselves on the line out there ahead of everyone when the weather isn't perfect, in order to get those lines in and do it in a safe way so that when the weather does become perfect somewhere in mid to late May, then all the climbing teams can go up and make their attempts.
Several comments around the icefall doctors as well. And they're managed by the SPCC, Sagarmatha Pollution Control Committee. But those guys, you know, I've got pictures, I'm sure you do too, of them going up through the icefall with a ladder lashed on their pack. And it's just, my gosh. And, you know, we always talk about avoiding, minimizing the time you spend in the icefall, but I mean, those guys, they spend all their time in the icefall.
Yeah. They live in the icefall. And it's a dangerous place, as we all know. It's moving, maybe a meter every day. Crevasses open, ice blocks or racks fall over. And I did have the opportunity to meet Nima Sherpa, who was the longtime chief icefall doctor until a few years ago when he died. He died in his home from an illness, not from an accident on the mountain, but he spent decades up there in the ice fall, and he had such a connection to the mountain and to the ice fall and to all the Sherpas on the mountain. And they just revered him, not only his crew of ice fall doctors, but all the other climbing Sherpas. And he just had the sixth sense. He knew when things were safe or unsafe. And I remember one day we were up there and just coming down from camp one, there was a section where a big ice tower was hanging over the route. And he said, it's not safe. Let's wait. And everybody waited a few hours. Eventually that ice tower fell down wow. over the route. And then everyone continued and found a new way through it. And nobody was injured or killed. And he just knew that it wasn't a safe time. So that type of experience and knowledge and connection to the mountain and understanding, and he was able to communicate that to others, I think was a real gift. And I think he's passed that on to some of the ice ball doctors that have filled his footsteps.
Yeah, that's great. I love that story. Speaking of that, last autumn, when you were there with the Mountain Hardware team, and by the way, I'm going to add to this this post excellent video that you and the Mountain Hardware team made about what it takes to go climb Mount Everest. So that'll be part of this overall update. But you and the Mountain Hardware team turned back because of this serac that had kind of moved off of the west shoulder, and I understand that it's still there today, but it's filled in. A lot of snow and ice have filled in that gap that was so obvious. Tell us, as we wrap up here, just tell us a little bit about what was going through your head, and how would you have handled that this spring if you would have gone?
Gosh, yeah. So last autumn we got to base camp and we started mobilizing and climbing up to the ice fall to camp one, and after we got to camp one, We got eyes on this serac that was about 800 meters above the Khumbu Icefall route, we estimated. And it was tough to see from base camp, but you could make out a tower that was leaning. And one of the teams had a drone and was able to get some really good footage of this ice tower. And we estimated the size of it, if it collapsed, which it looked like it would collapse because every day it was leaning more and more apparently, that it would be over 1 million cubic feet of ice coming down 800 meters and wow. hitting the ice fall route that goes right underneath it and then blasting across the ice fall over to Nupse. And there would be a wide swath of terrain which would sustain that wind blast and debris blast. And it would be something similar to what happened in the Nepal earthquake, April 25th, 2015, when that ice block came down off of Pomori. And it wasn't the ice that hit base camp, but the wind blast generated by that avalanche that carried through and hit base camp. So we estimated it would be something similar. And we just could not take the risk. And the two Polish teams also agreed they couldn't take the risk going through there. We couldn't take the risk sending our Sherpas through that area in the ice fall because they have to go up and down a lot more than we do as climbers. And we couldn't justify our own lives going underneath that ice block. Now, Killian Jornet could. He was climbing independently. He doesn't have a team of Sherpas or other climbers. He had one climbing partner, but he moved so fast and efficiently. He could run up underneath that ice block and only be under it for maybe a matter of a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
So he could justify it, but we couldn't. And we feel good about our decision in not continuing to climb after we discovered that big hanging serac. And we watched it every day and it seemed to hang a little bit further over and we kept waiting for it to collapse and come down so we could resume climbing, but it never did. And I understand now that it's still up there. I hope that it's stabilized and hopefully we'll be up there for a long time and
yeah.
and not come down when people are underneath it.
Hope so. You know, I think that, again, some people underestimate what the responsibility of an expedition leader is. They may oversimplify and say, well, look, I'm paying you to get me to the summit, when in reality, at least my view has always been that I'm paying you to get me back home alive. And this example in autumn of 2019 is a classic example. Mm-hmm. So my friend, as we wrap up here, you get the final word. Madison Mountaineering has really just blossomed into one of the major guide companies on the planet. There's a handful of them out there. You guys have a very enviable safety record and success record, and you know, seems like you're doing a lot of things right, Garrett. So where are you going to be taking the company, and what do you see as mountaineering as it continues to evolve?
Gosh, I just feel so lucky to be able to go out into the mountains with other enthusiastic people that hold the same values as I do in terms of teamwork, safety, respect of local cultures, the environment, and of experiencing personal growth by pushing ourselves outside of our comfort zones on some of these mountaineering and climbing endeavors. I hope to be out there for as long as I can. I love sharing the journey with fellow climbers, whether it's on an 8,000 meter peak or my home peak of Mount Rainier, where I grew up. And I really hope that that these times will pass soon and we can get back out there doing what we love. Until then, as I told you before our call, I'm just using this time to do some meaningful work for myself on my business, but also on me personally. I'm looking at this time as a gift in my schedule and just trying to utilize every day, and looking forward to when we can get back out there and climb the big peaks again.
All right. Well, that sounds great. You know, I do hope you get a chance to go in the autumn, and because for many, many reasons, the least of which being that that would imply that we've got a handle on this virus and that Nepal is open back up for tourism, the entire country, adventure tourism from rafting to safaris to mountain climbing and trekking is just right now devastated, and it's impacting so, so many people. So thank you for participating in this virtual Everest project and raising money on behalf of all of the climbing Sherpas. And I wish you all the best, my friend. So take care of yourself and enjoy Hawaii.
I'd like to say thank you for doing the virtual Everest blog series this spring, because it's been great to bring awareness to the people affected by this virus, and especially the Nepal mountain workers, the Sherpas, who are missing out on the bulk of their earnings for the year. It's been really tough on them. We've made a commitment from our team to do what we can to help them, and we're planning on heading back there as soon as we can, hopefully in the autumn, to do more climbing. But I really appreciate you doing your virtual series and raising awareness and helping us raise funds to support their families. Thank you.
You're very welcome, and thank you. Couldn't do it without the collective community, the collective climbing community. And I'm just so gratified and also so proud of our climbing community. Okay, Garrett. I normally say namaste, but maybe I should say aloha this time.
Yes. Mahalo.
Mahalo. Take care, my friend.
Thanks, Alan.